What I want to talk about tonight is one of the things that I find in the courts of heaven and in the counsel of the Lord. One of the things that I find that is really, really necessary for us to function there is for us to be remembered. Now, we might say, well, God remembers us. Yeah, God does remember us. But there's something very significant about being remembered by God that sometimes maybe we don't understand how significant that is. Let me read the scripture to you. It's in Malachi chapter 3, and I want to read verses 16 and 17. Malachi 3, verses 16 and 17. Because God makes a very precious promise to us here right at the end of the Old Testament. It says in verse 16, "Then those who feared the Lord spoke to one another, and the Lord listened and heard them." Watch this. "So a book of remembrance was written before him for those who feared the Lord and who meditated on his name." Verse 17, "They shall be mine, says the Lord of hosts, on the day that I make them my jewels, and I will spare them as a man spares his own son who serves him." So here's what God says. He says, whenever people do a certain thing, there's going to be a book of remembrance that is written in heaven. So watch. We talk about Psalms 139, 16, and the book that was written about us before time began. That's the book of our destiny. That all of our days yet unfashioned, all of our substance yet unformed, it was written down in the book before time began. And we are here to live out that book and to flesh out that book into reality. And the enemy fights us legally to try to stop that from happening. We know about that book. We know about the Lamb's Book of Life. We know about several different books. But the Bible says here that there is a book, that just like there's a book that was created before time began, there is now a book, or there can be, books of remembrance that are presently being written. In other words, everything's not written that's ever going to be written. There's still books being written that are in heaven. And one of those books that is being written is called the Book of Remembrance. And so when the Bible talks about a book of remembrance, here's what it's talking about. It's talking about a book in heaven that causes God to remember us. That's what it's talking about. It's not talking about us remembering God. It's talking about a book that causes God to remember us. Now, the Jews believe that these books that are written, please hear this, literally present themselves in the courts of heaven and open themselves and begin to speak in our behalf. That causes God to remember us, watch this, above all the other people on the face of the earth. This is what they believe. Now, I believe that these books of remembrance are voices that are one of what I believe is 10 voices that speak in the courts of heaven in our behalf. See, Hebrews 12, 22-24 lists 8. Finances that we bring is 9. And books of remembrance is the 10th voice that can speak in the courts of heaven that causes God to remember us. I was sharing that with somebody, and they said, well, that makes sense because the Beit Din is made up of 10 judges. I said, well, yeah, it can be. But here's the point. There are books of remembrance in heaven, watch this, that we have a part in creating. That we have a part in creating. See, sometimes people wonder, watch this, why it seemed like God forgot them. Maybe you feel like you've been forgotten by God. Maybe you feel like that your prayers hit the ceiling and bounce back. I want to tell you something. Literally, you need to know how to create books of remembrance that cause God to remember you. That God gives us some instructions on what's involved in books of remembrance being created so God remembers. See, this is now listen, this is one of my daily prayers. Can I come down here? Okay. This is my daily prayer. Okay, here's my daily prayer. Lord, I agree with the blood of Jesus that's speaking in my behalf that causes me to be forgiven and need to be remembered before God. I thank you, Lord, that the blood of Jesus cleanses me from all unrighteousness. I thank you, Lord, that that there's angels that bear me up in their hands, and my family, lest I would dash my feet against a stone. I thank you that your covenant care surrounds me as the mountain surrounds Jerusalem. I thank you that your name is a high tower that we as the righteous run into and are safe. And I say then, Lord, I thank you that there are books of remembrance in heaven that are speaking that cause you to remember me and my house.
Hallelujah.
And then I say this. I say, Lord, and I declare that my house is as the house of Cornelius, that became the portal through which you entered the Gentile world. I say, my house shall be a portal that you touch nations through.
Yes.
And then I say, I thank you, Lord, my house is as the house of Obed-Edom.
Yeah.
It is a house where the presence of God dwells, and the blessing and the increase of God is upon it. And I thank you that my house is as a centurion soldier's house, that you went to his house and released healing into his house, and that my house is full of your healing and health.
Yeah.
And I make those decrees over my life and over my house every day of my life. And so as a result of those, we live a blessed life. But here's one of the main ones. I didn't always do this. The Lord spoke to me, and he said, began to declare that there are books of remembrance that cause you to be remembered before me. Now, let me just point this out to you. And so you'll see this. You say, well, I don't really understand what you're saying. Okay, Acts chapter 10. Cornelius is a Roman centurion. He has a charge of 100 Roman soldiers. But he fears God, and he does the best he can in serving him. Okay, he prays and gives alms. An angel shows up in his house and says, your prayers and your alms, I think it's Acts 10:4, have come up before me as a, what? Memorial. In other words, Cornelius, even as a lost person, you have done something that has caused a book of remembrance to speak before my throne in your behalf. Now watch this. It caused God to remember him so that God chose Cornelius' house. Please hear this. He chose Cornelius' house as the portal through which he would enter the Gentile world. Out of all the other Gentile houses on the face of the earth, Cornelius has got chosen. Why? Because Cornelius had done something that created a book of remembrance that caused God to remember him. In other words, he stopped being a statistic and became noticed by God. See, David said, what is man that you are mindful of him? Or the son of man that you should take knowledge of him? But you have set him over the works of your hands. See, what was David said? He was amazed that God would remember him. That he would choose him. See, please hear me. We know God loves us. But God also wants us to do the things that cause him to remember us. I don't think, it seems like I'm not getting it across. That literally, this is the thing that makes your life potentially become special because God is remembering you because you have a book of remembrance speaking in your behalf and others don't. You need to learn how to create a book of remembrance. You need a book of remembrance speaking in your behalf or you will live a life not so special. It's true. You've got to have a book of remembrance. You've got to have something in the spirit realm that is speaking in your behalf before the throne of God that is causing God to remember you so that he will do for you what others don't get done. This is what it means to have a book of remembrance. So let me just kind of walk through this for just a few moments. What happens when God remembers us? Let me just show you a few things here. What happens when God remembers? Genesis 8:1, the Bible says God remembered Noah. Now that shouldn't have been a hard task. He's the only guy left on the earth. And yet the Bible says God remembered Noah. So obviously it wasn't just about how many people were on the earth. So you know, God can remember. No, it's making a statement here that God remembered Noah. That means that God's heart was moved toward Noah. That God took knowledge of Noah. That God remembered the promises he had made to Noah. That Noah was special before God. Because God remembered him. So it wasn't about there being so many people and Noah remembered out of them. It was about God saying, I remember you and I'm going to fulfill my word concerning you. I'm going to bring to pass what I've said about you. So God remembered Noah. See, anytime you read the word remember in this context, it's actually speaking of the covenant-keeping nature of God. That because of covenant, God remembers. God remembers. Let me give you a second one. The Bible says in Genesis 30, verse 22, God remembered Rachel because she was barren and couldn't bear children. But the Bible says God remembered her, and in that the Bible says God remembered her, it means he visited her. That he caused a barren womb to conceive and to be able to form a child and to bring forth that child because God remembered Rachel. And out of that remembrance, he visited her and broke the barrenness out of her life. See, maybe you feel like that there's maybe natural barrenness, or maybe you feel like there's just barrenness and there's no fruitfulness in your life. You need God to remember you. You see, when I learned how to pray this prayer, when I learned how to function in this realm, I'm telling you something, everything started changing in my life. Opportunities started being presented to me that were not being presented to me before. Doors started opening to me that were not being opened before. Because I began to learn how to pray, God, let there be a book of remembrance that speaks in my behalf before you. Number three, God remembered Abraham, this is a neat one, and spared Lot. Genesis 19:29. Remember, God begins to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah, but before he does, the Bible says he goes to Lot and seeks to bring Lot and his family out. Why? Because Lot was so precious to God? No, because Abraham was so precious to God. That the Bible says that God, watch this, didn't remember Lot, he remembered Abraham. And he went and delivered Lot because he remembered Abraham. Because Abraham, as I said this morning, was God's friend. But please hear what I'm about to say. It was God remembering Abraham that caused Lot to get saved. To be spared. What? God will spare your children because he remembers you. God will spare, listen, that which is precious to you because he remembers you. See, I base a lot of my confidence in my future and my hope based on the fact that I have a relationship with God that causes him to remember me. Therefore, those things that are precious to me are going to be protected and guarded and kept and saved and spared because God may not remember them, but he remembers me.
Amen.
So listen, that's a good reason to have a book of remembrance.
Amen.
Speaking in your behalf so that God remembers you. Because there's a book of remembrance in the court of heaven causing God to remember you and be able to render verdicts in your behalf. Number four, God remembered Israel in captivity because of their groanings. Exodus 2:24. He remembered Israel. When he heard the groanings of Israel, he remembered Israel, what happened? God then raised up a deliverer named Moses. Now, it took a while. It's quite interesting. God heard their groanings. He then had to let a woman get pregnant. be able to bring forth the deliverer. I mean, it took a basic lifetime, but it all started because of the groanings of people that caused God to remember them. See, I think it's Psalms chapter 5 that talks about the Lord hearing not necessarily just our prayers, but the sighing of our hearts. See, listen, let me tell you what groaning is. Groaning is a deep level of intercession. The Bible talks about Romans chapter 8, about the groaning of the earth and the groaning of us in the earth that literally is intercession that allows God's purposes to be birthed and born in the earth. So when the children of Israel groaned underneath their oppression, it moved God to remember them, and He set in motion what was necessary for a deliverer to come forth and deliverance to be seen. Number 5, God remembered people in war. We'll get more into this in just a moment, but Numbers chapter 10 and verse 9, there were 2 silver trumpets that were created. And when they would blow these trumpets over Israel, God would remember them as they went to war. See, we've got to understand the things that creates books of remembrance that causes God to remember us. And so they would go to war and God would remember them in battle so that they would win the battle rather than lose it. Because God would go out with their armies and fight for them and fight with them. We'll get back to that in just a moment. Number 6, God remembered Hannah. 1 Samuel 1:9. Remember, she's in bitterness of soul. Bitterness of soul. And the Bible says she's in the temple of God. And she's speaking, her mouth is moving, but there's no sound coming out. And Eli thinks she's drunk. And he says, how long, you know, are you going to be in this state here in the temple of God? And she says, please don't esteem me as a daughter of Belial. I'm pouring my complaint out to the Lord. And the Bible says God remembered her, visited her, and she brought forth Samuel, and then brought forth sons and daughters after Samuel. But I want you to hear something. When God remembered Hannah, please hear what I'm about to say. Hannah got the desire of her heart, but God got his voice. See, some people wonder, why is God letting me go through such bitterness of soul? Because He's not just going to give you your desire, He's going to get His purpose as well. Amen. You see, Hannah, God allowed her to come to this deep place before He, quote unquote, remembered her, because He intended not only to meet her need and meet the cry of her heart, but to get what He needed in the earth, which was a voice. His name was Samuel. See, sometimes we wonder, what in the world is going on in my life? Why am I going through such places of pain and disappointment? Because God's trying to birth His purposes in you and through you. He's after something more. It's not just a cruel, nasty world we live in. God says, I am intending on bringing you through this, but in the process, I'm not only going to meet your need and the cry of your heart, I'm also going to get my purposes out of the situation. And then God remembered her. God remembered her. Okay, let me just do this. How do we see these books of remembrance created that allows God to remember? Because please hear me. God doesn't just remember because He chooses to. I believe He remembers because there's a book speaking in heaven, in our behalf. There's something in the spirit realm that's speaking. And please, we must know how to create these books. They're not already there. The Bible says very clearly, God heard them, and He responded, and caused a book of remembrance to be written that could then speak before Him so that He could remember them in the process. So how do we see books of remembrance created? Let me just give you some real quick things here. Number 1, we see them remembered by us walking in the fear of the Lord. This is important. Malachi 3:16. Then those who feared the Lord spoke to one another. And then the latter part of the verse says, for those who fear the Lord and meditate on His name. See, the fear of the Lord is absolutely essential to books of remembrance being written. And here's our problem in today's church. We don't have any fear of God. We have very little fear of God. There's being messages preached that do not gender and give birth to the fear of God. It says you can live any old way you want to live and it's okay with God. I got news for you. That is not true. That's a delusion. That's a delight. That's a doctrine of demons. It's not true. You cannot live any old way you want to live and God be okay with it. It's simply not true. I don't care who tells you that or how many, you know, famous preachers you see on television telling you that. It's simply not true. It goes against the very thing that the Bible teaches us. So it says that when they walked in the fear of the Lord. Now, it's very important because the fear of the Lord, we don't understand. We don't even understand what it is. We think it's being afraid of God that He's going to get us or something. That's not the fear of the Lord. See, if that's your attitude, then you don't understand His nature. You see, the fear of the Lord, I love what I heard a preacher say years ago, Tony Evans, out of Oak Cliff, Texas. I remember him saying, he said, you fear the Lord when you know you can't jive with Him anymore. That's what he said. Shuck and jive. He said, you can't do that with God. He said, if you shucking and jiving with God, that's what he said. He said, if you shucking and jiving with God, he said, you don't fear God. He said, you think you can manipulate Him, you can play Him. And He's okay with it. He said, no. He said, there's the fear of the Lord. How many in the early church, they walked in the fear of the Lord and the comfort of the Holy Spirit. See, we want the comfort of the Holy Spirit side, but we don't want the fear of the Lord. You see, the fear of the Lord, when it comes, it settles on us and causes us to order our life in such a way that with all the depths of our heart, we desire to be pleasing to Him. Okay, Acts 2:43. Let me just real quickly tell you this. So, not a few years back now, I had a dream. And in the dream, I'm sitting on an airplane. And I'm in first class in my dream, which I am on a fairly regular basis because of how much I fly. And so I'm sitting in first class, and the flight attendant, before the plane takes off, says, she comes on the intercom and she says, she calls my name and she says, you know, come forward. So I get up out of my seat and go forward. And she looks at me and she said, you've been upgraded. And I'm thinking, I'm in first class. Where am I going? And I suddenly realized that I was on a double-decker plane. I didn't realize it at that point. But then I realized I'm on a double-decker plane. And she said, you've been upgraded to a suite in the upper deck. Out of a seat in first class to a suite in the upper deck. And this is what she said. And you're in suite 243. Well, when she said suite 243, in the dream, the Holy Spirit said Acts 243. Well, how do you know when I woke up the next morning, I went and got my Bible to see what Acts 243 said. And here's what it said. The fear of the Lord was upon them, and many signs and wonders were done through the hands of the apostles. And this is what the Lord said. I am upgrading you into apostolic signs and wonders. Now, I also knew that those double-decker planes, they fly international. And I have seen some things happen on the international level, a few things here. But the bottom line, and I'm still... See, how do you know when God gives you a word, you contend to move into it? That's even about the course of heaven. I don't want to go there tonight. But the bottom line is this. It says that the fear of the Lord was upon them. Watch this. Which is the atmosphere that's created for apostolic signs and wonders to occur. See, if you want apostolic signs and wonders, which are the ones that challenge and change culture.
Yes.
If you want apostolic signs and wonders, you're going to have an atmosphere of the fear of the Lord. that allows those kinds of signs and wonders to happen. Because it says, the fear of the Lord was upon them all, and many signs and wonders were done through the hands of the apostles. The word many means so many, they were common. It wasn't they finding an acorn, a blind hog fog and finding an acorn every now and then. That's a southern saying. A blind hog will find an acorn every now and then. That means even anybody's going to get it right occasionally. What's it? But God said to me, I'm going to upgrade you. But here's what's going to happen. Before you see the signs and wonders, the apostolic signs and wonders, watch this. You're going to first see the atmosphere of the fear of the Lord begin to come. Back into the church. So that there's a holy reverence and awe of God that comes back again. Now watch what it says. The Bible says when they're walking in the fear of the Lord, this is what allows God to write a book of remembrance concerning us. If you want a book of remembrance, then I would challenge us. Let's learn to practice the fear of the Lord. Let's learn to walk in the fear of the Lord. Listen, if we want a book of remembrance, let's say, Lord, watch this. Teach me the fear of the Lord. That's what David said in Psalms 35, I think. He said, teach me. Teach me the fear of the Lord. Because we don't know anything about it anymore. Because watch this. You got the lawless that don't know the first thing about the fear of the Lord. And then you got the legalists that are perverting it. And trying to use it to manipulate people for their own cause. And both of them are evil before God. No, we need a real revival of the fear of God that comes, and I promise you, that must happen before mighty signs and wonders are seen through apostolic hands and an apostolic church. But when the fear of the Lord comes, it will cause and allow a book of remembrance to be written. Number two, it says that they meditated upon His name. That word meditate means to weave.
Yeah.
It means to weave together. See, here's what I believe He's saying. When they meditate upon His name, in other words, when they are woven into His character, and His character is woven into them.
Yeah.
Because His name speaks of His character. So God says, when you meditate upon My name, watch this. Meditation upon His name, it does speak, I believe it speaks of the weaving of the character of God into the very fabric of our life. Let me explain to you this one. When I look at my computer sometimes, especially my laptop, and as I'm looking at the computer, I'll have my reading glasses on. Not because I need them. No, I'll have my reading glasses on because it is easier to see. Because you see, I'm restrained so much. But see, several years ago, I had to have a cataract taken off, a new lens put into this eye, and then the next year a new lens put into this eye because I had cataracts. And I was really young. The doctor said, "Have you ever had blows to the eye?" I said, "Why?" Because he saw a scar above one of my eyes. He said, "Because you're awful young to have cataracts." And he said, "And one of the things that causes them is blows to the eyes." I said, "Well, yeah, I have blows. I have blows to both eyes." Because I was really a rambunctious person. The first blow I had to the eye was I was setting up in the pickup. You remember the pickups in like the 60s? They had metal dashboards. Remember that? And my sister pulled into the driveway. We hit a hole in the driveway. And when it did, my head came down and hit the metal dashboard and busted my head right above my eye, which is where he saw the scar. So that was one of them. But then the other one came because when I was pastoring the church in Texas, we had a Christian school. And one year I coached the six-man tackle football team. And we decided, and I was in really, really good shape. And I was in the best shape of my life. I mean, I was working out all the, you know, I've been working out pumping weights and running and all sorts of things. And I would literally suit up with the guys. I was 35 years old, and I would pound them. I love it. Remember I told you about the violence. I love that. I love to hit people. I love to play football, and I love to hit people. I was 150 pounds soaking wet senior in high school. I won all district as a defensive end. Because what they said, all we want you to do is every time the ball snap, just go as hard as you can in the backfield and cause as much chaos as you can. I said, I can do that. Like, there's other stories connected. Anyway, so we came up with this idea that we were going to play the alumni that had been a very good team for the last few years in a fundraising game, and all of us coaches and some of the dads were going to be on the other team. So we had put this game together. And, I mean, some people thought we were crazy. Because we're a bunch of, you know, 35, and some are older than that. So we put the game together, and the day we're supposed to play, it rains like cats and dogs. And literally, when we took the field, there was that much water standing on the field. We should have canceled the game, but we weren't about to. The referees that we had hired to come referee, they came out and they said, What is this? We were told to come referee this game. And I told them, I said, you should be, look at this field. You should be. I said, no, we're playing. We're paying you. Get out here and call this game. So there's this one guy that actually was one of my pastors later on. He's a really, really good running back in high school, because he said he ran so fast and so hard because he didn't want to get hit. Because a six man, that's pretty easy to do. All right, so anyway, it was for him. Anyway, long story short, he had graduated, and we had been trash talking for quite a while leading up to this game. So I remember the last play of the first half, he comes around the end, and I square up on him, and I'm thinking, you're not going to juke me. And I mean, I put my helmet in his chest, and I drove him back, and he hit the ground, and I landed on top of him. Last play, they blew the whistle at halftime. And he's literally laying on the ground, get off me! So that's how we went to half. Okay, the second half starts. The second half starts, and he runs around the end again. And they have him stood up on the sideline. They got him boxed in, and they got a hold of him, and his name is Wright, and they've got him stood up on the sideline, and I'm coming full bore. And I'm thinking, I am going to nail him. And I launched into the air like a missile. I launched heading toward him, and I hit him, and when I hit him, this was the first thought in my head. I had a helmet on, didn't have no face mask here, and this part was open. The first thought in my head was, when I hit him, who has a brick on this field? Because something came through that helmet and nailed my eye. And it felt like a brick hit me. Here's what I found out. We watched the film. His shoulder pad was stuck up. And that pad came through and nailed my eye. So I am... Okay, let me get up. I'm on the ground like this. I'm sitting on the ground, and I'm thinking, what hit me? And there's water all around. It's raining. And it's cold. And I raise my head and look up, and I'm seeing the ground. And I'm thinking, the blow knocked my eye out of the socket. It is hanging out of my socket. Oh my! And so I took my hand. I'm reaching up underneath, trying to see if my eye is hanging out of my socket. And I couldn't, and then I discovered I couldn't feel my face. What had happened was I had what they call a blowout. It had cracked the socket. And the eyeball was still in, but it had dropped down. And so, literally, everything was out of whack. Everything. So whenever I looked, I still to this day do not know why this eye wasn't working, because I was sitting on the ground with it too, but anyway. The long story short is there's no purpose for that story. Because I actually forgot the point I was trying to make. But if we're going to have a book of remembrance, let's get back to our point. If we're going to have a book of remembrance, if that's going to happen, we're going to have to walk in the fear of the Lord. And we need to literally say, Lord, help me understand your fear. Help me understand the fear of the Lord so that my life is overtaken by it. And my decisions are governed by it. Because God honors those that fear Him. And those who meditate upon His name. Amen. That we literally get woven into the very character and likeness of God. Let me just say this about meditating on His name. When we meditate on the name of the Lord, the Bible says that we are to be like Him and made in form and fashion into His image. Amen. So let me just finish this. I got off on that. Let me finish this story about my dad. So when I look into my, I said I can do this here. See, I'm looking into my computer and I see my image. Okay. And so when I put my reading glasses on and I look into it, sometimes I look at that computer and think, how did my dad get in that computer? Because I'm looking and I'm thinking, that's my dad staring back at me. Now, I never did think that before, except for the older I get. Because the older I get, the more I look like my father. And the Lord spoke to me and He said, that's the way it's supposed to work.
Wow.
He said, the older you get in me, the more you mature in me, the more the reflection of who the Father is ought to shine through. That you begin to develop His character because His very nature is being woven into your life. See, the Bible says as that develops, because the book of remembrance is written about us in heaven, that God begins to write this book and cause us to be remembered. Amen. Number three, we're almost done. It says we speak often one to each other. Here's what this means. That's a reason. That's a really good reason to go to church.
Amen.
We speak often one to each other. In other words, we have fellowship one with each other. Because the Bible, if I'm reading this right, when we come together and we're excited about the Lord and we speak often one to each other, watch what it says. It says that they write that down and record it. That there are angels recording our fellowship and our communion one with each other. That there is literally a book of remembrance that's written about us so that God remembers us and spares us as a man spares his son. Okay, number four. We should, to have books of remembrance written in our behalf, we should pray and give. Acts 10 is a really good example of this. Let me show you this real quickly. Acts 10. Cornelius was remembered because he prayed and gave alms. It caused a book of remembrance to be written in his behalf. Here's what you got to understand this. Leviticus 5:12 and Numbers 5:26 says that there was a memorial portion of every offering. In other words, when they would bring a grain offering to the priest, the priest would take a handful and they would throw it into the fire. And that portion that went into the fire that would, as it were, symbolically at least, ascend before God from the flames, it would cause God to remember the one who brought the offering. That's just Bible. that literally the priests would take the rest of the offering for their livelihood. But the handful portion was thrown in the fire. It was called the memorial portion.
That's good.
You've got to understand, our offerings cause God to remember us. The offerings don't just pay the pastor. The offerings don't just keep the light on. The offerings don't just pay for the building. The offerings literally create a memorial, a book of remembrance that causes God to remember you. That's what the Bible teaches. That's why God remembered Cornelius. Because his prayers and his giving created a memorial before God that spoke in the courts of heaven and caused God to remember him and allowed God to choose his house above all of the houses as a gate through which he would enter the Gentile world. The Holy Spirit would be poured through Cornelius' house into the Gentile world. Because there was an offering that he gave, an offerings that he gave that created a memorial. So our offerings have much more power than we think they have.
Amen.
And you can, even as we're saying it, you can feel in the atmosphere.
Yes.
The Holy Spirit said, you need to get it.
Hallelujah.
Amen. We're getting it.
Hallelujah.
That you through prayer and through the giving of offerings, can literally see a book of remembrance written. See, I believe with all my heart that my wife and I have been such extravagant givers that it has caused the book of remembrance to be written in heaven about us. I believe that. And because we have done that, God remembers us. This is a really good reason not to be stingy. This is a really good reason to be liberal. Because heaven is aware of our giving. And we can talk about many different things. Let me give you number five. Just two more real quickly. Well, no. Let's just do one more.
No.
More.
Okay, let me just give you this. Luke 7, 1 through 10. This one will blow you away. Luke 7, 1 through 10. The centurion soldier, remember that I told you about?
Yes.
See, I mean, no, he was a centurion soldier. He had no drawing rights from Jesus. He was a Greek. He was a Gentile. Remember the Syrophoenician woman that said, heal my daughter. She lies at home sick with a demon. And Jesus said, it's not right for me to take the children's bread and give it to the dogs. It's not your time yet. So the centurion soldier was in that same situation. But he had a servant at home that was sick. So the elders of the Jews came to Jesus and said to Jesus, could you please go heal his servant? For he loves our nation. Now watch this. And he has built us a synagogue. Watch this. He has built us, or if you will, he has built God a house. So because he had taken his own money, because the Bible says he built it, his own expense, and he had built a house of God for the people of God, Jesus said, I will go.
Amen.
And he went to the house, and when he got to the house, the centurion soldier sent another servant out and said, don't bother to come in, just speak the word. For I'm a man under authority, and I have men under authority under me. In other words, Jesus, I understand the principle of alignment.
Yeah.
So I know, watch this, I understand how words have power. Because I am under the Roman government's authority, my words carry power and people obey me. I know, Jesus, you are under the authority of the kingdom of God out of heaven. Therefore, your words carry authority, not just in the natural realm, but in the spirit realm. So just like my words move soldiers, your words will cause demons to flee.
Amen.
So all you have to do is speak the word, and my servant will be well.
Amen.
And Jesus said, I've not found such great faith, not even in Israel. But what allowed Jesus, or what allowed the centurion soldier For Jesus even come to his house. It was his giving. It was his heart to build God a house. Because here's the principle. If you build God's house, God will build your house.
Amen.
That's throughout Scripture. It's a principle throughout Scripture. When you put your efforts and energies into the building of a house of God, God says, I'm now released to build your house. In other words, watch this. The centurion's heart to build a house caused God to remember him.
Amen.
Among many other people that would not have been remembered. Okay, the last one. Let me give you this one. Numbers 10:10. I love this one. Again, it's the two silver trumpets. It's not the shofar, but it's the silver trumpets. That Moses, God told Moses to have Aaron build. And they built them. They built each trumpet out of one piece. They beat it into shape. And there was these trumpets were used for lots of different things. But one of the things they were used for was when they would bring the whole burnt offerings and their sacrifices, these trumpets would be blown over those offerings. And when they would blow them over the offerings, it says that it would create a memorial that would cause God to remember them.
Yes.
See, here, you got to get this. Don't give your money, don't give your offerings without blowing the trumpets over them.
Amen.
Why was it two? Because I believe we need to blow the apostolic and the prophetic trumpets over our offerings. Because when we blow them, if you will, prophesy over the offerings, it causes those offerings to create a memorial in the spirit realm that is a book of remembrance, and God remembers us. So don't just give out of some responsibility. Give with an apostolic and prophetic declaration over your giving that literally moves things in the spirit, creates a book of remembrance, and causes God to remember you. Because when God remembers you, good things happen. All of a sudden, uncommon favor starts to be your portion.
Amen.
Uncommon favor starts to be your normal because God's remembering you. As we practiced the principles and sought to create books of remembrance that would speak before the courts of heaven, but also as I have said, in agreement with that, Lord, let these books speak before you. We have watched, in my estimation, uncommon favor come upon our life. But what should happen? Because God remembers us. You see, what's the difference between me and somebody else? God remembers me. What's the difference between you and somebody else? God remembers you. But books of remembrance don't just happen. You have to be a part of creating them. This is why God put this stuff in the Word. So that we know how to create these books that speak before the court of heaven and cause us to be remembered. Amen? Would you stand with me tonight? Thank you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Father, even as we just stand before you right now, Lord, we just want to say, I want to say, let there be books of remembrance that would speak for us, that would cause us to be remembered before you. Lord, we know you love us. We know you care for us. We know you died for us, Lord Jesus. We know your blood speaks for us, Lord. We know all of that. But your word is very clear. That there's books of remembrance that can be created in the spirit realm that can speak and cause us to be remembered. And Lord, there's some in this room that feel like they've been completely forgotten by you. Lord, they know down deep in their heart that that's not true. But Lord, their experience might seem to say that you've not really been real interested. Lord, I want to declare, let books of remembrance be created. Let books of remembrance be created, Lord. That began to speak in the spirit realm. Lord, thank you for doing this even now, Lord Jesus. Lord, we just want to say that we want to walk in the fear of the Lord.
Yes.
We want to meditate upon your name. We want to speak often one to each other, Lord Jesus. Lord, we want to pray and give extravagantly, Lord Jesus. We want to release the memorial portion before you. We want to be a part of building your house so that you, Lord, can build and bless our house. We want to blow the apostolic and prophetic decree and trumpets, Lord, over our offerings, Lord, that causes the books of remembrance to be created, Lord. Thank you for this, Lord. Thank you for this, Lord. Could you just lift your hands and just begin to worship Him for just a moment? Thank you, Lord, for just being among us, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for just being among us, Lord. That you would be among us. That we would be among us, Lord. That we would not be those that are forgotten before you, but you would be with us, Lord. Lord, and I say, and this is what I hear, even, Lord, that, Lord, even as you remember us, that there is breakthroughs that began to come. There's breakthroughs that began to come. Lord, that which we have been waiting on, and that which we have been desiring, and that which we have been longing for, and even needing, Lord, that there would be breakthroughs that would begin to come because you are remembering us, Lord. Because you have remembered us as your people, O God. You have remembered us, Lord. And because you remember us even as your ecclesia, Lord, things shift and move in cities and in states and in nations. Lord, we want to declare that there is books of remembrance, that there be books of remembrance that are written in our behalf, O God, and cause us, Lord, to be remembered before you, Lord Jesus. Cause us to be remembered before you, Lord. Father, let the breakthrough of God come. Let the breakthrough of God come, Lord Jesus. Let the breakthrough of God come. Lord, we want to even say, as Isaiah the prophet, Lord, spoke, and he said, why is my just claim passed over? Lord, he was asking a question that there would be people that would say, my just claim, Lord, my righteous claim that I lifted up before you, Lord, why is it passed over? Why is there no response from heaven concerning it? Lord, I say, let there be books of remembrance created that allows these just claims to be heard and to be responded to out of your courts, Lord Jesus. That you would remember us, O God. That you would remember us, O God. That you would remember our cry.